So, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm glad to see that the coffee is starting to flow and the talk's going really well. So, it's a great pleasure to be inviting up our next speaker, who's going to be talking about inherited cybersecurity on everything from nuclear power plants to oil rigs. So, please give a huge round of applause for Aleksander Gorkowienko.
Good morning, RSA. So, is it good time to talk? Is it too early to talk about security of industrial control systems? What do you think? Is it not? All right. Okay. So let's get started. So let's say for the beginning a couple of words about what ICS is. Well, industrial control systems are—it's a variety of different systems used to control and manage industrial processes, manufacturing processes, critical national infrastructure, oil and gas pipelines, transportation—you name it. So those systems are slightly different from normal IT as we know it. So those systems are quite often proprietary. They have long service lifespan. Sometimes they had like more than 20 years. So they were initially designed and created long before all this modern technology, super connected everything. So those systems, because they were designed about 15 or 20 years ago, quite often they are not easy upgradable, or even more, they are not upgradable at all, because well, this little device, which is a part of ICS system provided by the vendor, and this vendor does not exist anymore. Device still works, and we pray it still will be working tomorrow. So. Typical ICS architecture. So we have our corporate network where we have all typical problems we know for IT. We have viruses, we have malware, we have clicking wrong links, etc., etc. And on the other side, we have a realm of control network. We have PLCs, we have field devices, we have robots, we have sensors, we have actuators, everything which makes our manufacturing or oil pipelines running. So to combine these two worlds, two realms together, it's not an easy task, because obviously the last thing we really want is to introduce all those vulnerabilities, all those problems from corporate network into the control network, right? At the same time, we want to have a visibility. We want to know how those technological processes are running. So it's difficult. We have different systems helping us with that, but nothing is perfect. So is ICS and SCADA system, is it secure? Well, I would say the decision should be made by you, but I'll just give you a couple of interesting facts. So ICS is quite often managed by engineers, not by IT. And engineers, they're very smart guys, and I really admire how they can build those complex systems, how they can create this absolutely insanely complex machinery. But at the same time, they are not aware, quite often, even of basic security principles. That's sad. Again, legacy systems, 10 or 20 years old, quite often are combined together with the newest solutions. And we have a very shaky combination, because those systems which were built 15 years ago, they were not designed to be online. But suddenly, we have an idea to connect it all together. And we have very unpleasant situation, because we have to lower the level on which those devices communicate, those newest and the old ones. So therefore, we're actually reducing the security level quite often. Those ICS and SCADA systems are very, quite often, vulnerable to denial of service, and they cannot even withstand a normal NMAP scan. So forget about testing live systems, really. Proprietary protocols, again, were designed 20 years ago. They are wrapped nicely in modern TCP and UDP, but again, it's inside, they are in clear text, and they are not secure. So security by obscurity is, I would say, one of the guiding principles of the operation technology these days. This creates a set of quite serious problems, really. Because I can quote Bruce Schneier from DEF CON last year, when he said, you know, the moment where IT security problems were only in IT realm, it's gone. It's not anymore, because we have so many devices, everything's interconnected, and it's heavily interacted with physical life, with the world we live in. And I think ICS, it's ideal place, really, where you can see that IT problems with security might lead to literally lethal consequences, very tangible, very physical, affecting not only safety and security of people, but also life sometimes. So quite often, obviously from the attacker's perspective, most interesting thing is actually to break this famous air gap, right? How to get from the IT to OT. And well, there are different options. We can talk about sniffing in the air. We can talk about sniffing van act fields and a variety of out-of-band channels. But I can just remember an interesting concept, philosophical concept from some Middle Ages, really, called Occam's Razor. It says that actually you should not overcomplicate things if you can reach it in very simple and straight way. And who but hackers, they know about it really well. So old USB pen drives, they still work. So you can distribute malware, you can distribute Trojan horses with this. Technicians, they have, laptops not updated since they were given to them, probably last 10 years. And this leads to serious problems, because you have PDF reader, which is 10 years old, and it's very, very easily exploitable these days. Separate thing, I should say, about hacking this through supply chain, because obviously it would be difficult to hack, nuclear power plant, because it's difficult. But it's much easier to hack the supplier of PLC devices for the nuclear power plant. And you can introduce some malware, or you can just reflash the device, put this malware inside, and then you have very, very nice situation, because once it's deployed, it will probably stay there forever, because factory acceptance tests last for, 2 or 3 years. So once it's there, it's there. You have perfect backdoor for forever, pretty much. So these are problems, and hackers know about them really very well. Another interesting thing is that, obviously, we like technology, and we introduce a variety of modern ICS remote clients. And these are web applications, these are mobile devices, and this is great, because we now can manage manufacturing processes on distance of thousands of miles, which is fantastic. But at the same time, we are introducing a huge area of well-known vulnerabilities, such as SQL injections, such as cross-site scripting, direct object references, you name it. So, and all those things which are well-known to hackers are introduced into ICS world. It's literally a paradise for hackers. So what kind of tools attackers need? Well, again, because everything is more and more connected, many industrial devices are featuring TCP networks. So it's easy. You use tools which normally are used for analyzing and probing infrastructure. Sniff in the air. You need, obviously, to be able to write scripts to program, because it requires not only knowledge of those industrial protocols, but be able to manipulate them on the fly and do many interesting things. So sometimes, obviously, if you're on site, you need hardware for connecting to ICS systems. But generally, again, these are things which are well known, and they could lead to serious security problems, because hackers know them really, really well. So now I want to talk a bit about one case study. Is a test for oil and gas industry, and I tell you how we could hack FPSO. Anyone knows what FPSO is? FPSO is floating, long name, floating production storage and offloading vessel. So it's like a massive ship, and it's like a floating manufacturing. They're located near the drilling platforms, and they connected by huge pipes, and they're taking the crude oil from there, and they're providing a variety of different chemicals needed for drilling process. And so it's like floating, literally floating manufacturing. So we tested that, and obviously the report was huge. And today I just want to focus only on two things. Actually breaking the air gap and telling you a bit about man in the middle. So let's take over the air gap first. Air gap server. So we have HMI server, HMI human machine interface, connected to like hundreds of different PLCs, and each of those is connected to different actuators, sensors, and machinery making all this thing working. The HMI server was accessible only through a KVM, and you have screen, you have keyboard, and a mouse, and this all is connected through fiber optic link. They are physically located in two distant locations on the ship, right? So you can't get there. The server itself is in a highly protected area. You can't use USB, you can't copy anything from the HMI server once it's there, which is great. So we thought how we can transfer something to it and how we can get files from this server through the KVM. So a bit of experimenting, and we found that the server, HMI server, has Windows 7 installed, hooray, unpatched, double hooray, no AV, and the original idea of designers was that the HMI is supposed to be working as a kiosk, right? So no access to the OS. So people who are playing with infrastructure are quite familiar with that, and it's not so difficult really to break this thing and have access, establish access to the operating system. Once we are there, we found that actually we have two things we need to hug the server. We can hug the server with Windows Notepad. So we have a tool called cert util exe, and this is a really tiny tool which is a part of standard Windows distribution. It's on all servers, and it's generally is used to convert or manage some certificates. But it has also very nice side effect from a Docker's point of view. It allows you to convert binary file to Base64 encoded text file, and vice versa. And obviously you have Notepad. What else do you need to hack? We also use the thing called Bash Bunny. Bash Bunny is a multifunctional tool, but in our case, we use it as a, I would call it, keyboard on steroids. So we swap it with the keyboard, which was connected to the KVM, but it was a trick because the keyboard was whitelisted. So we had first to copy the exact hardware IDs from the keyboard and program the Bash Bunny correctly. So that's a whole process, how we can transfer something to the air-gapped server. On the attacker's machine, we have binary file we want to transfer. We use cert util tool to convert it to Base64 encoded file. Once we have this file, it's plain text, plain text. We convert it with another tool, our own Python script, to instructions for Bash Bunny. We upload it to Bash Bunny and stick Bash Bunny to the KVM. Once we have this, on the other side, we have opened Notepad, and we actually literally typing the whole content of the binary file in Base64 encoded form to the open Notepad on the HMI server. Once it's done, we repeat the whole story in reversed order. So we use the same cert util exe, and we change it back to the binary form. Job done. Nice and easy. So now the question is how we can turn it back, how we can get something from the HMI server. And there were lots of interesting things there. There were configuration files with plain text credentials. The whole HMI system was written in .NET, so C#, and everyone knows that C# is absolutely fantastic. Why is that? Because it's perfectly reversible, right? So it would be nice to take those binaries back. So how we can do that? Because we can't stick USB, we can't use USB stick and just copy it to there. So we did something very tricky. So we transferred to the HMI server our own little utility, which actually converts any content, any binary file, to a QR code. And then you can use just normal mobile phone scanner and scan this code and have your file back. So that's how it works. So now we can. I want to talk a bit about man-in-the-middle attack. So man-in-the-middle, it's again nothing new. It's classic approach, and all hackers in the world probably know about that. We have parties in the switch network. We have HMI in this case, and PLC, and attacker connected to the same router. So obviously, in this case, attacker will not be able to see any traffic between HMI and PLC, and they're exchanging data every second, or probably even more. So what can we do? We can do something called ARP spoofing. So we send ARP message to the network saying that from now on, I'm associated with this IP address and that IP address. And those parties say, okay, that's fine. If you say this, let's do it. So the next step is very nice because all traffic just goes through you. And once it goes through you, you can do absolutely anything with it. So what we managed to do, we can sniff network traffic. We can not only sniff, but also tamper the information. We could read registers from PLCs, but we also discovered that you can not only read registers, you can also write to those registers. And this is even more interesting because the system, there are many safety systems in this whole vessel. Because if some of operational parameters are changed, it does immediate emergency shutdown. So if you can provide the wrong value of temperature or pressure, which is constantly updated in one of registers of PLC, the whole system just stops. Another interesting application of the same vulnerability is attacking NTP server. So all devices on the ship, they use a date timestamp provided by central source of this information. So we thought, okay, what would happen if we intercept those NTP packets and we swap with something completely random? It's not as easy. It's easier said than done because actually it doesn't work like this. If you change it to random value, the router, for example, it checks the how big is the difference to the previous value. If it's too big, it just ignores you. It just adds you to the blacklist. So still, how can you do something in this case or not? So we thought, yeah, we can, but we have to be smart. So instead of providing random number, we provided a value which is only slightly deviate from the real time. And so it's still in the window of acceptance by hardware. And so, all right, okay, it's just plus minus 1 second, who cares? But in the next iteration, we add one more second or two more seconds. So we're still in this safe window, but the difference to real time is increasing with every hop. So these are applications, very nice practical applications of man-in-the-middle attack. What can we do to improve security of industrial control systems? I think you should really change your mindset first, because security is not one-off thing, it's a continuous process. I should probably mention something which is really well known in manufacturing business called the Toyota Way. It's a set of guidelines first published by Toyota, I think, in 2001, saying how large organization, how they see the large organization should develop a different type of business in a safe and good manner. So those guidelines, in my opinion, are perfectly applicable to IT security world and specifically to ICS world. Why is that? Take a look. So one of those guidelines is saying that every vulnerability, once identified, should be resolved as soon as possible. So you should never drag this vulnerability with you for the next couple of years once you know it's there. It's imperative. Second thing, people who are involved, so all whole organizations should have certain level of security awareness, and everyone should be allowed to say that if they see that something is wrong. So it always should be treated with respect and dignity, and some actions should be taken. And one of the probably famous principles from the Toyota Way is this continuous improvement. Because, you know, we are humans and we're making mistakes, and this is normal, it's inevitable. So we have to deal with this, we have to face it and find the way how we still can do business and, well, make mistakes. So this can be done by the process of iterative continuous improvement. So you do some testing, you do some assessment, you understand what the problems are, you do some fixes, you do recheck, and the circle starts again. How to make SCADA even more secure? I would probably say you should first map the network, identify to see what you have. Do you know what you have? Do you know all your IT assets? Do you know what your critical systems are? Are you really sure? And once you know them, once you identify those crown jewels, you have to think how you can efficiently reduce the attack surface. Maybe you should switch off some unnecessary services. Maybe you should close some ports. Maybe you should patch. But anyway, no matter what you do, you should never assume security. It's very, very important. Always have it tested. This would be almost impossible not to say anything about defense in depth, right? So I thought I will show it to you as slices of Swiss cheese. So each slice, it's like a lever of protection, and this layer has holes because nothing is ideal. And we can put different layers, and those holes are in different places. So if you have an attacker who can successfully penetrate, let's say, level 1 and level 2, but they would be actually stopped by level 3. So that's, I think, it's a very good way to understand how defense in depth actually works. Another thing which you should seriously consider is to use network segmentation, because again, all, especially those critical parts of OT should be clearly separated with traffic regulated between them. Because if you have a breach, if someone actually managed to reach the OT network, at least their lateral movements would be limited. And this is already good. Generally, you would never, and you should probably forget the idea that you will have, you can make your system completely safe. It will never happen. You can reduce the probability of being exploited or being hacked. And this is already very good. So, in my opinion, education is very important. It's a key to success, and it's not only for IT and OT. The whole organization, also management, I think probably you should start from management, should be aware of those security problems, and this awareness gives a chance to actually to deal with those problems in an efficient way. By the way, we have a very interesting demo of hacking energy distribution system at our booth, so you are more than welcome to come later on, and you can see how you can hack the grid. So wrapping the whole thing up, key takeaways. I think the holistic approach to security is actually key to success. People, as I said already, people are making mistakes. They will be making mistakes, right? The question is, will you be able to run your business knowing this and handle this correctly? So technology, the newest and best technology will never help if you don't have right policies and you don't have understanding of those policies. You know, I'm a very tactical person myself, but I'm humanist. I don't believe that the better world will be built by smart technology. I believe that it will be built by smart people. And I think this is actually, I think the message from RSA this year. So I think we should really think about it and think again. So forget about air gap. So this perfect air gap does not exist. So sooner or later, someone will find some ingenious way to break it. So again, this repetitive process of circles where you check and recheck security again is the only way you can maintain the level, security level right. That's probably it from my side. Do you have any questions? Yes, please. Yes, yes. So KVM had USB connectors, but you could, yeah. So you could connect to it the keyboard, but keyboard, for example, was whitelisted. So before we want to use Bash Bunny, we had to unplug the keyboard, connect to our laptop, grab those IDs, and reconfigure Bash Bunny so it can work properly and can emulate, you know, mimic the right keyboard. Any questions? Yes. Yes, as I said, so the question was about do we have remote management systems? Yes, definitely. And I think vendors these days, they obviously aware that they're introducing those attack surfaces, like as I said in my presentation. So they have web applications. Web applications are really well known to attackers. And obviously, there are multitude of ways how they can be exploited. So that's why those vendors are, for example, coming to us. And they so we do tests for them before those products go to the market. So yes, we are aware, and vendors are aware of this. Sorry? Specifically on IoT front, are you seeing any emergence of IoT? IoT is slightly different area, but For example, there are certain certification bodies and vendors of IoT solutions, they kind of mandate those vendors to follow those guidelines. And that's also what we do. So you can talk to us maybe after the presentation. Any more questions? Yes, please. Sorry for?
Insider threats.
Probably I have to prepare a separate presentation, a really long talk about this. It's very difficult. Probably it's, again, it's human element, right? So how are you going to analyze the human element? How are you going to find the human needle in a human haystack? It's open questions and probably would be difficult. Yes, you can analyze emails. You can use AI to go through all these zillions of bytes of data sent and received. In my opinion, we still don't have ultimate solutions for this. It's better you work as man to man, as human, and you can understand and prevent those things on a human level rather than on technological level.
But the newer breach and attack simulation systems actually help
to address that. The question was how we can prevent the how we can detect malicious insiders. Any more questions? Any other questions? Yes, please.
I've been told, and you mentioned it, that there are certain conditions under which upgrades are simply not possible. Should we consider normal upgrades of an attack vector?
Very much possible. So probably in someone can criticize me, but I would probably say that in OT world, there is no such thing as a normal upgrade. It's almost never happening. It's complicated. Yes, it's one of probably very much possible attack vectors because you have firmware and you have to do something or change the configuration of the device. And this is a wonderful way to implant something there. Any more questions? Questions? Okay, thank you very much for attention. Thank you for coming here. So enjoy RSA and stay safe. Thank you.